the response is the Ragnaros. They want to make sure they have some control. That will be the solo laner. So Rag up against Office. Office being such a bully in that lane. And we do tend to see a Leoric as a respect pick the trigger up against it. Whether or not that will come in later does provide some good wave clear. But combined with the Rag, you'd expect it has to be the Malfurion, surely.
I'd love to see it. Yep, Skimmy, you called it. I'd love to see a Malfurion go with the Rag. We saw how well it sort of worked in the previous game. They just go together so well. There are some heroes that just, when you've got a team that goes so synergistically, like you want to keep them together, right? And in saying that, Lucio is still on the table to then complement Arthas. So whether we want to see Lleyton FC sort of pick that up right now, I'm not sure if they will, but once again, it's just all about complementing your team fight and really enable Arthas to be more of a threat.
Yeah, definitely with Mouth being taken off the board, which is a great pairing with the Arthas, I would say, yeah, potentially Lucio is still on the cards. Otherwise, they might have a different option to consider, given that both Tess and Xayah are still available. Xayah is going to be the first one locked in there, combined with the Lucio too. So we are just on the money today, Vandy.
They're reading our thoughts. It goes so well. As I said about rotations, Lucio can really, really enable that. And then Xayah, Arthas really setting them up with strong, strong kill potential right there. And same being said, I guess, for the Ragnaros and Malfurion combo going out for when they do have to engage in team fights, just giving them a lot of CC. And I guess now what I want to see coming out of ECAT now would then be whether they start to build up their front line. So I guess who would go well on this map? They still have quite a lot on the table. I mean, they can pick up Falstad. Johanna's still on the board if they want someone to engage. Johanna'd be nice for setting up, I guess, a team fight in terms of, like, she can engage with the Blessed Shield. But they have... Ooh, I like this. They've gone for Ban. So instinctively, that sort of then indicates to us that they didn't want anyone to have that sort of poke and that sort of executioner style on them.
Well, I mean,
for that Ragnaros.
Yeah, I mean, given what we can see so far from the side of Lleyton FC, where they got this combo that's sticking around, fighting for as long as possible, they want a big backline at AA, combined with Xayah, making sure that that person finds some value. So great ban to stick with the Grey Man, given that Vala was already taken off the board. You touched briefly on what tank ECAT want to rock with, and we see Muradin banned straight away as a result too. So it does leave, like you said, you know, the Johanna, ETC potentially, even Leoric, like we touched on briefly before. Generally, if you go for Leoric, you want somebody else to pair quite nicely with him.
Like, I do like Leoric because of the targets that he has in terms of Arthas and Xayah. I feel like they just wouldn't get enough out of him in terms of, yes, he can entomb, but where does it go from there?
Yep.
They're still lacking more sort of that blow-up combo to really capitalize on that. Like, they can still pick him. They don't need to rush. It's just going to depend on, I guess, what else they want to pair with that. So that's, I guess, what they're dipping into with their time here, how they want to finish this off. I think having a global would be nicer. I mean, Falstad, as I said, is still on the board. It would still complement them quite well.
I feel like at this stage, given that the side of Lleyton FC is going pure sustain, pure sticking around, making sure that they can find some value in, you know, keep you around long enough to actually get the kill. They want some burst in some respect. Johanna is going to be a great result as a result for that, given the fact that she has the good wave clear as well as the iron skin. And Gul'dan then actually allows them to break everything up with the Horrify.
Yeah, that's great. So Gul'dan will be sort of like the, uh-oh, we're getting too aggroed upon. I don't want to say aggressed. But like, uh-oh, the fight is sort of just like being put into our court right there. And then we want to disengage. Or it can be used as the engagement, depending on how they sort of, if there's a pick on the way. So really, really clever drafting, giving them a lot of CC. So they're really going to be able to dictate the fights quite nicely, ECAT's composition.
Well, much like what we saw in Tomb of Spider Queen from Morton's list, it gives them that wave clear so they can bounce between mid and bot, and they'll be able to smash that out, pretty much deterring any chance for Lleyton FC to actually find a fight. They might have to play a little bit more desperately. Mouth will have the scouting drone available if he decides that option. And that should then give them a bit of protection when rotating through that pesky bush in the mid lane.
Yeah, I do believe that people have sort of been referring to that bush as like almost a Bermuda Triangle because of just the way it's structured out. But essentially, if you can sort of capitalize and control that area, it really then makes it all that much longer to try and rotate down to the bottom lanes unless you have a global. So it's all about playing the mind games and controlling the map as best you can. I really do like that Nazebo pick as well because, once again, just very strong at wave clearing, except, as we sort of saw in the previous game, if he has a lot of pressure in the early game and he can't sort of reach mid and late, he kind of really doesn't have much of a presence.
this opens up the door now, given it's a bit of a different draft. They need some dive in some respect. Same once more with the Rag and Gul'dan, obviously in different compositions this time, but it wouldn't surprise me if they were to open with, say, Zeratul or even potentially Diablo.
Exactly. It's interesting, though, because E-Cat, what I'm sort of envisioning as well, it depends on how Lucio sort of plays it with his speed boost as well as in the positioning that he gives them. If he can sort of bait out the ultimates early and then sort of, say, Jahan opens up and there's not much engagement, they really have all the tools to sort of be able to kite around and sort of dictate it that way. But there's just so much CC coming out from E-Cat that if they do land one, it's just going to be that chain sort of effect happening. And I'm not even sure if Zarya's shields are going to be enough to save him.
They do finally lock him with the Anubrax, so a great hero to do great work against both Jaina and Azir, but it's going to be their preference here. But that's a lot of melee potential, obviously big wings in terms of Gul'dan having to try and actually carry this game from the back line. It's going to be Chrysometer on that one, but a bit of a different direction, I suppose, with the Zarya. They've decided not to go for the auto attack route, go double mage, and this is this is going to be an interesting one, Andy.
Yeah, it's going to come down to be quite an interesting match. It's going to be match 4. I'm not sure if this is going to be a quick one, Skimmy. We've had a couple of quick ones tonight. But Dragon Shy can be one of the ones where it can be quite dragged out depending on how they play it. So same. If you kind of get the first couple Dragon Knights, he does scale as the game goes on. So you'll find the more the game goes on as well, the stronger the Dragon Knight gets and the more important it is to secure it. So it's all going to come down to that.
All going to come down to how this Nazebo player plays and make sure he does not get picked off like last game. But let's jump in, guys. Game before, blue hand side it is. Cat, Curiosity playing Johanna, Sorelli on Ragnaros, Zemmour on Anubarak, Chrysometer is on the Gul'dan, and Moondrew is supporting on Malfurion.
And red team on the right hand side, we have Lleyton FC, Jaddy on Lucio, Vicarak on Zarya, Sharpaw playing Arthas, Against Time on Jaina, and Godzilla playing Nazebo.
Playing Nazebo, we need to keep a big, careful eye on how these teams decide to do it because, yeah, like you mentioned, one comp is looking for wave, clearly other is looking to try and find picks and kills, but they don't have the most burst in the world. They do obviously have Jaina to try and find members, but already we can see Vicarak is going to go a bit of an adaptation on that standard Zarya build.
Yeah, so he's gone more of that sort of basic attack build, so meaning that he's going to melt you. Vicarak's going to be making sure that he can stack that energy up and then just sit there and melt you with the laser.
Seems to actually find a fair bit of value when comps are very melee-centric because he can just stand there all day and hit as many targets as possible and, well, fun things tend to happen there where kills go across, and that's exactly what they're looking for here. Humming Blast is good! Zeebo Zombie Wall was even better, but just at the last nick of time, Curiosity finds his way out. And we go to the standard laning phase after the kerfuffle in mid.
Flexing their muscles once again, especially Zarya. Once you have a sort of champion that doesn't tap into any mana, as you said, so valuable, can just sit there for days.
Well, this could be a bit of a threat for them right now in the bot lane. Lleyton FC are going to be taking a chunk of continuous damage here. Jaddy will do a bit of work with the healing passive, bouncing around in a sustained area, but if they can coordinate this well, those members are going to get shredded down before Jaddy can even respond.
Now with the shrines up as well, it's going to come down to who can win that top lane battle and secure it for longer. So Sarah Lee once again playing the Ragnaros. We've seen him play a very nice convincing one before. And I mean, in terms of just the sustain, once again, Ragnaros versus Arthas, they both have sustain at their disposal, and they can both sort of outstand each other. It's going to come down to, I guess, how much damage Ragnaros can hit with his meteors to poke, just how quickly he can clear the wave.
Yeah, you can see right now, if he does go in close to try and get his Sophia stacks, he's going to get punished and take a lot of damage as a result. You can see both down to half, but Sharper right now with the advantage with the point control. All eyes on bot lane, though, right now. That's where we're looking and focusing on. It seems to be that Zarya tried to force their Curiosity, got a little bit aggressive there. But right now, it's a double channel for the side of red team.
Exactly, but they cannot cap yet because Chrysometer is doing a great job of keeping Godzilla down low. They just need a bit of a gank after they can sort of secure this point to once again put some pressure on Godzilla and then free up that lane.
Yeah, not really going to be able to find any pressure as a result, though, because like I said, all their eggs are in that Gul'dan basket, and if he's forced to go wave clear, you know, two tanks and a healer, what can you really do? Zetrion trying to get aggressive there with the Burrow. But, you know, they're just going to take a lot of beatings for free.
Exactly, and you can see how much healing Jaddy is just pumping out as well. When you have those... Ooh! Look at Vicarek's energy bar, Skimmy.
Yeah, this is really where, the feel the heat comes into its own. Oh, Chrysometer so lucky to get out of there, but Zepline won't share that same fate. He does get taken down. Moondrood is now coming back for the supporting duties, but the damage is already done. Both still have been capped. Against Time is sticking around despite having no mana, and this actually might allow E-Cat to respond.
Definitely. I mean, but look at this. Lleyton FC, they wasted no time in getting that first Dragon Knight of the game, and it allowed them to push through into mid because we've still got team members of ECAT respawning and running down mid.
And as a result of the amount of pressure that Lleyton FC have been exerting in these side lanes, actually mid had no tower ammo left, so this Dragon's going to do a lot of damage. Depending on how he decides to play this one, he might just go straight down to bot lane as well, which has also been completely depleted of ammo.
That's exactly how you want to sort of set it up for the Dragon Knight coming out, because really allow him to get as much value out of the early Dragon Knights as possible. If you can sort of get those early objectives by clearing out the turrets from the front wall, it can give you so much of an experience lead, as we're starting to see here on Lleyton FC.
Look at this, Vandy. Vic has just literally stood still for the last 10 seconds. He's just letting his auto attack do the work. He says, I've got shields, I've got energy, you should be the one running. I'm just gonna absolutely smash you.
Shields and heals. Jaddy has not left his side and is just doing a great job of healing for him.
Switch your attention to the top lane for a second though, because it seems that Sorelli has actually got the better of Sharper eventually, despite losing the cap and allowing the Dragon to go in Lleyton FC's favor. Ragnaros starting to come into his own, got a few talents on his side now, and he's actually starting to make a difference with his passive.
It's great to see, but look at how aggressive Lleyton FC is in terms of how much base they've conquered, in terms of looking how much ECAT has sort of captured, really just showing how much more siege they have in comparison.
They're really getting punished in this bot lane as a result of how weak it is. They have invested so much into this Gul'dan that this triple camp or this triple squad really can't really do too much. Godzilla's going to come in for the rotate, Gul'dan's going to come around there, and Lucio does get taken out despite what I said. They're saying, look, we do have damage, we just got to choose, click and point at the right time. Oh, a beautiful root there, does find a second kill, and Against Time without any mana is going to get locked in by Zepline. Team is just nowhere near to follow up, but regardless, a great little skirmish.
That was well played by ECAT. That's exactly what they need to do. With the aggressive positioning coming out of Lleyton FC, they needed to capitalize on that because it was just free kills, as you said. Being pushed up that far with such low health and mana available, yeah, it was just asking for that gank, and it was great to see that Chrysometer reacted as soon as Zeba went down to rotate, he followed him.
It's actually made a fair difference because they were down a full level, but now they're in touching distance, both so close to level 10, but it seemed to be the case in bot lane. Soak as much damage, take as much beating as possible, and when they're let's force the fight then. Well, from Srelli has come in with the rotate, gonna rock on by with the drive-by, say, let me just get some stacks and run back because it's shrine time, activating in 10 seconds.
And I like what Lleyton FC is doing here by capping that night camp. They're going to put that added pressure on. Yes, we can say that ECAT has the golems, but night camp can push on for so, so much longer. So I really would have liked to see ECAT do the same and also take their night camp, but instead they were trying to look for some more kills and clear out those waves, which is good. But 10 has been picked up by Lleyton FC at this point.
Yeah, very small window of opportunity for them to try and do anything with it, and they're going to try and force it anyway. Ring of Frost is beautiful! It might keep Vicarac alive just long enough. Even Moondruid, his Twilight Dream got interrupted. Clutch stuff here. Jaddy just bouncing around. He's having an absolute field day with the stuff. Zepline is going to pop the Locust Swarm. Burrow Charge not finding as much value as it would have liked. Spiders doing work. Members dying across the board. Lucio does pay the price in the end, but I know which trader I'd rather favor. 4-2. Thank you very much.
Oh my goodness, Lleyton FC clearing up there. I'm not really sure why ECAT was forcing so hard. They literally got 10 in the midst of that, and then that, oh my god, the Ring of Frost, you'd be so chuffed with that. That was perfect. Textbook, if you must.
Yeah, a lot of resources committed there to try and take out Vicarac, and it just ran out of steam. And once more, another dragon is being picked up by Lleyton FC. Arthas is still doing so much work, and you have to say that dragon was really aided by the fact that they had the night camp that you put on.
Yep, exactly. The night camp was pushing that whole time and really distracting ECAT's focus for that map. So that's exactly what the difference that Merc camps can make. And really, Lleyton FC played that one quite well.
Dragon is still punching on hard through this mid lane. They wanted to try to go for this full 20 seconds still left on it. Members are surrounding, 4 to be specific. They're going to try and actually rotate here. So whilst the Dragon's keeping those members amused, Jaina's actually split pushing in the bot whilst the rest of Lleyton FC are pushing on the top. They are really min-maxing this XP soak.
That's really great to see. Yes, someone could argue you want to go with the Dragonite, but it's still early days. It doesn't yet have that oomph that you sort of see in the later games. So once they hit level 13 onwards, you really start to see the Dragonite hit a punch. So they said, instead, we're going to sort of divide and conquer. And there's a bit of a skirmish breaking out here with Sharper.
So on a defensive, Modern Core was popped. Oh, Horrify completely whiffing there, hitting the ground. Twilight Dream is going to find some value. Same with the Sulfurous Smash. Dropping down the beat just a little bit too late there, but can they get the retaliation? Yes, he can. The boop securing the kill. Support these support walls, but he pays the price. And this is a bloodbath in this top lane. People trading lives back and forth. Vicrack just trying to buy time. He might get out. He's got the shield active. Does he have tap? No! He does get snuffed at the very last second, and Sorelli gets a little bit of vengeance.
They did not want them to walk out unscathed by that. They had so much overkill at their disposal. They're like, no, you're not walking out of that one. That was really well done by ECAT. See, it's all about those rotations. Yes, I liked what Lleyton FC was doing in terms of the dividing, but it really shows, you can see exactly where everyone is. So it's like, oh, there's only this many people up here. Or, oh, there's only this many. Like, it really telegraphed that to ECAT, and ECAT was able to respond accordingly to that.
Accordingly, they have indeed. They're going to go for their night camp right now, try and get some map pressure in that top lane, whilst the rest of Lleyton FC deciding that they want to try and set up a bit of a gank squad. They've seen that cap has gone down. They are looking for some member to go for that rotate. Hanging around in this bush, pings have gone out. Might actually try and get this flank on Ragnaros. He's going to be careful here. He's not actually got the mount up. Oh, Howling Blast does whip. Might actually buy him enough time. Expulsion Zone isn't perfect, but it's going to be good enough. They're going to completely separate him out. Four members commit to this. Sulfurous Smash! It's enough! Jetty dropping down the beat once again, just a little bit too late. Wasn't as clean as it could have been.
One could argue that was a 5v1 and Sarah Lee still managed to take down someone with it. So that was really nicely done by Sarah Lee to stall so long. But it's going to be a bit of a base race now.
It is. I mean, ECAT were actually buying time. Rag would have made the call and saying, look, I'm getting jumped on. Actually try and force another objective in another area of the map, and it seems to be that Lleyton FC are going, we need to get a keep, we need to try and make something happen here. Take a fair chunk of damage though against time. I don't know if they realize this, but the response and the rotate has already come. Ring of Frost is huge once again, but Vicrack, he can't shield because he's been Twilight Dreamed. Ice Block prevents any way for Moondrew to be taken out. Seems to be, once again, let's boost and let's run away.
Oh, I mean, I was getting worried there for Lleyton FC. I thought they were definitely overstaying their welcome. It was good that ECAT went back because an outer fort versus a keep, obviously the keep holds way more priority. And they did manage to pick up a kill there. So it's really good timing in terms of the shrines being up as well for them. Hopefully they can capitalize more on this and then maybe force a Merc camp, but going to be interesting to see what they want to do with this.
Pretty rough for Lleyton FC there, because you actually saw Sharper rotate and actually completely ignore those golems. He had to go and get the shrine in the bot lane, and those golems did so much work, nearly taking out the outer keep's first tower. So really min-maxing, it's actually given ECAT the advantage now. They're level 16, they're going to take out this fort in the top lane, and this is really when it's going to come into its own. This is the first game tonight where it's actually gone more than 10 minutes, so we're actually going to see a mid to late game this time, Dandy.
Yay! It's my favorite part of the game. But in saying that, oh, they are hot on their heels with Lleyton FC. There goes the Expulsion Zone.
Expulsion Zone is good. Once again, catching out two members. They're completely separated, ECAT, right now. If Lleyton FC can abuse this, they can find some kills. Both tanks in the front line. There is one Locust Swarm. Horrify is huge. It gets some members away, but the Ring of Frost is even better. Everybody fighting in that 3-for-2 right now. Lleyton FC still looking for more if they can, but so dangerously low. Against time, actually walks into the root saying, I don't even care. He's going to go for that cap in the top lane. Still two very healthy members in the mid lane. And you have to admit, this is going to be another dragon, surely.
It would have to be. Vicarek setting up such a good team fight. That's exactly why Expulsion Zone can be such a terror. Making sure that the positioning of the fight was going to go the way they wanted. And really, I mean, when I'm seeing them both fight on even grounds when they're not getting separated, the fights are really, really close. Like, even though, yes, they separated team members of ECAT, look at how close they were. Like, they were still quite low. They just didn't have enough to finish them off. And a Dragonite at this point, Skimmy, it's starting to get to the late game stages. So this Dragonite's going to pack some punch now to the point where you can start to group with it.
Absolutely going to put a priority in the bot lane, mainly because that's what all the mercs are. You want to try and take out that keep and really min-max here. But I was just going to touch on, I don't know whether or not ECAT realized that Against Time actually did not go back. He is still extremely low inside that Dragon. So if he pops out in a dangerous position, He is an easy target, making it a 4v5. He's taking so much damage before his dragon's even accomplished anything.
Exactly. Also, against time is their Ring of Frost, which is a huge portion of their damage. So it's going to be better, I guess, once against time is out in terms of how they can fight.
Oh, Vandy, look at that. Instantly with the shield, Ring of Frost, and the expulsion zone. They are just going straight in with the ultimates. Twilight Dream finding some kills. Doom take out Lucio, so there's no Sand Barrier now. And it seems to be that the tanks on the front line for Ecat are forced to retreat once more. Howling Blast catching out Chrysometer. Sharp is trying to go for it. They do pick him up in the end. Against time is still alive. Somebody kill this guy.
This is where you just want some sort of global ultimate to sort of just kill him because he's just so low. But that was exactly it, Skimmy. I was saying, generally with the Dragonite, you don't want your DPS to be in it, nor do you want your support to be in it. But he was so low, he was the only one to sort of get it. And almost he was saying, all right, if you guys do get me out, this is the time where we can fight because I've got my ultimate up. Let's go. And that's exactly what he did. As soon as it was popped, Vicarek shielded him. Beautifully executed team fight right there. And while that whole skirmish was going on, there was a Knight Camp in the top lane pushing.
I was just going to say, on a Troll Valley, Vicarek just expulsion zoned the Knight Camp in the bot lane. So really trying to, you know, take that one as quickly as possible. That's exactly what that ultimate's for. But I suppose when it's on a 45-second cooldown, who really cares?
Exactly. Every little moment sort of helped him there. It was worth it for the Knight Camp, he's saying, because look at how many mercs they've captured now and how many they've got pushing for them. So putting so much pressure on the map for Ecat to deal with.
I think he's just really hoping that producer Crisis did not catch that on camera. But if he did, that's meme value right there and then. But as you touched off on, the keep in the top lane is extremely low. No mule, no way for that to be healed back up again. And it all came down to just utilizing the merc pressure. But Triant once more up in 10 seconds. We're getting very close to this late game now. 20 is on the horizon, and you can tell that the rest of Ecat want to try and force the fight before 20 is being picked up.
Ecat are hungry for that fight. They know that this is the time. Otherwise, like you said, they're going to be down a talent here. And it appears that I'm lagging, Skimmy, so don't mind me.
Do indeed. That seems to be the case that Ecat are going to go pick up some mercs. They're going to try and actually put a bit of a priority in this top lane. They're currently getting out-rotated. Maybe not the wisest decision to go for that one. Jaina does pick up bot lane. They need to force a fight now. Still no level 20. Still, it's a 5v4 in their favor. They do go straight on in. They're going to try and find out Lucio. Drop in the barrier. And they do keep him up for a little bit longer. In with Sharper. He's suspending himself with Yummy the Dead. But Chrysometer's blocked him with a beautiful zombie wall. There's no way he can get out. Oh, Ice Block. Perfectly negating the Ring of Frost. That's two members gone down now for Ecat. This is just hurtling so well. So furious smash. So really, every single time takes one to the grave with him. Beautiful performance, but 20's been hit. Everybody's here for Lleyton FC. They are going through top lane. Surely they can pick up the keep.
Oh, I feel so bad for Ecat. That was such exactly what they needed to do. If they managed to take Jaddy down before he could use Soundwave, that would have been a Soundbarrier, that would have been a totally different story. But as you said, it was just the wrong thing to do. Against time, caught up, and then it was just GG right there. And look, Nazeba's also hit the late game, so it's just gonna be harder for Ecat. I believe it's gonna be over for them.
Everybody on the core now, still Dragon's gonna be picked up regardless. They've got that insurance policy, but they don't even need the Dragon. Gul'dan's up in 5 seconds, doesn't have Horrify for another 10 seconds, so there's no real delay tactics for this. GG has been called. It was Lleyton FC on the day, despite the sponsorship for the player. They still are true to their name and win.
Well played by Lleyton FC. It was such a great game. So much back and forth. As you said, we did manage to get to the late game as well, but that spelt disaster for Ecat. You don't let Nazebo get to the late game, and that's exactly why he just dishes out the damage. As soon as he lands those corpse spiders on anyone, I saw Chrysometer getting hit by them a couple of times. It just shreds your HP bar.
It was a game that did actually take us to 17 minutes, Lily, in this one. But Lleyton FC does take the win. A few honorable mentions in this one, starting off with Zaya doing a lot of work with that adaptator build, definitely against the melee, and some great expulsion zones. But Arthas really achieving so much work, constantly keeping all these members with little to no mobility locked in place and really amplifying what his prime mages can do.
Yep, exactly. But let me consider this. Against times, Ring of Frost were always making sure if they weren't hitting at least two or more, like, he was just so on point with them. And as you said, someone killed that guy because he was so low for half of the game as well. So I think my MVP might have gone with him, but I'll leave it with you, Skimmy.
Oh, pressure on me. I'm going to get witch hunted after this one. But yeah, as you do mention, against time with a clean score, great damage across the board and no deaths. So give it to the man in the mirror. There we go. Against time does pick up the nomination for the MVP for round number four. And well, we've still got one more game left off the five-week weekly here at Gamestah. So back to Kit Fox, and you can listen to about all the different skins we have to give away.
Absolutely, Skimmy, you nailed it on the head. After we come back from this short break, we will be drawing the Lucio? No, we're giving away the Probius bundle tonight. So Probius and the Terran skin. So for the last time tonight and for this qualifier season, exclamation mark, GS2Q into the Twitch chat for your last chance at getting that Probius bundle. And if you are unsuccessful at getting that, do not stress. We do have those deluxe machines of wars to give away as well at the $40 value. So follow those Gleam links as you've been doing so over the course of the last couple of weeks. And we'll be drawing those after the end of game number five. So we're just going to take a short break, ladies and gentlemen. And we'll be back. We'll be drawing the skin codes. We'll be playing Cursed Hollow. And we'll be giving away so much stuff. Don't go anywhere.